believe that this whole war on terror was the wrong way of fighting terrorism. I felt that it created more terrorism because of collateral damage. We were witness to that in our own country, in Pakistan's tribal areas. The more drone attacks, the more people got killed, their families got killed in drone attacks, the more people joined the militants. So I was opposed to this, and for that I was considered anti-American. I was considered someone who was pro-Taliban. So finally, the U.S. policy under President Trump is that there should be peace talks, and there should be a dialogue, and there should be a political settlement. So we came on the same page, and that's why I have a good relationship with Pakistan has, for the first time, a decent relationship with the United States, because relationships are built on common objectives. Previously, we had this awful situation where the U.S. expected Pakistan to help them win the war in Afghanistan. Pakistan should never have accepted this challenge by the U.S. because we could not do it. We couldn't deliver. And so our governments made the big mistake of agreeing to the U.S. what they couldn't deliver. As a result, we were reviled. We lost 70,000 people dead in this war on terror. And at the end, we were held responsible for the U.S. not succeeding. Now, objectives were same. Both the United States, Pakistan, Afghanistan want peace. It was just a question of how to get the Taliban talking to the U.S. and then to the Afghan government. So this was the main subject. Others were, of course, we want trade with the U.S. Pakistan wants help from the U.S. in improving our trading relationship, which was previously was just a transactional relationship, Pakistan to help the U.S. in the war on terror, and U.S. gave us aid. Now we want a proper relationship with the U.S.
The last time you met, President Trump suggested he might be willing to get involved in Kashmir. You've called to internationalize the issue before. India, of course, has always opposed it. Is there any chance that's going to happen?
Let me just say one thing. You know, when my government came into power, I am a firm believer that, you know, military is not a solution to ending conflicts. In fact, you go into a conflict with one objective, and then it spawns various other unintended consequences, and other conflicts come out of it. So from day one, you know, I believed that the only way forward was we have peace, try to have a peace settlement and help the U.S. Peace settlement with Afghanistan, mend our fences with Iran because there were some border issues we had with them, which we did. And then the next was India. And India, you know, I have to say that I'm probably the one Pakistani who I feel knows India much better than anyone else. I have probably more friendships than anyone else in India. And because of cricket being such a big thing in India and Pakistan, and because of that cricketing background, I felt that I was ideally placed in improving our relationship between the two countries. So immediately I reached out to Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and I was amazed that there was, the reaction was quite weird. Because, you know, we thought, you know, we said all our differences, which is mainly Kashmir, we could settle through dialogue. But, you know, the subcontinent hosts the greatest number of poor people in the world. And the best way to fight poverty is to have trading relationship between the two countries rather than spending that money on arms. So this is what I spoke to the Indian Prime Minister. But, you know, I came across a brick wall. And then really the events that happened, this suicide attack on in Pulwama in Indian side of Kashmir happened. Indian soldiers got killed. I immediately told him that if you can give us any actionable intelligence, we will act. But rather than act, they bombed us. So one of the Indian planes came down. We immediately returned the pilot, again saying that, you know, this is two nuclear-armed countries cannot afford a conflict. But really, it was after Mr. Modi won the second election, which was in 2018. And then when he annexed Kashmir, Kashmir, remember, is a disputed territory between Pakistan and India, according to the UN resolution 70 years ago, the 11 resolutions of the UN. And the people of Kashmir were supposed to decide their destiny through a referendum, a plebiscite. So India unilaterally annexed Kashmir, revoked their status, which was in their own constitution, this Article 370. And from then onwards, things went from bad to worse. And really, what is happening in India, let me just say one last word on that, because and I know India, I think it's a disaster for people of India. It's a bigger disaster for people of Kashmir, who for over 5 months now are literally in an open prison, kept there by 900,000 troops. It's a disaster for India because India is a multicultural society. It was the vision of Mahatma Gandhi and their first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, which was a secular society. And with this this philosophy, this ideology of Hindutva, which is the RSS philosophy, which was inspired by the Nazi it came about in 1925, which believed in the Hindu racial superiority, and also was built on hatred against other races like Muslims, Christians. So therefore, I feel bad because, you know, how can in such a huge country with a Muslim population of 200 million people, there are Christians there, there are Sikhs there, there are Dalits there, there are tribals. I just think that the path which India is going is a disaster for India. But I feel that for people of Kashmir right now, it is the biggest disaster because they are trying to change the demography of Kashmir, which actually is against the Fourth Geneva Convention, calls it a war crime. So yes, I'm worried about Kashmir, and that's also what I talked to President Trump about.
So you said a lot there that I want to pick up on. First, to return to India and Pakistan and the idea of war. You almost went to war last year. You recently said that Pakistan will find it increasingly difficult to remain inactive along the line of control if India continues its attacks there. So how close to another major conflict are we? What can you do to prevent it, and what can the rest of the world do to prevent it?
Well, we're not close to the conflict right now, but I'm just looking ahead, and that's why it's important that, you know, the United Nations must act, the US must act, because what I fear is what happened in Pulwama. We asked India that, look, this said attack has happened, you blamed us, please give us any actionable intelligence and we'll react. But the dossier arrived after the Indian jets had bombed Pakistan. So my worry is, and by the way, after that, the whole election campaign, which Narendra Modi won hands down, was actually hatred against Pakistan and this whole jingoism and war hysteria. So my worry is that, you know, if things get bad in India, there are protests in India against these two citizenship law and registration law, these two laws they brought about. There are protests going on in India now. Worry is that, you know, to take attention away from if things get worse there. Already there's a bombing along the line of control. Things could get worse, and they might just try and distract from that. So you cannot have two nuclear-armed countries even contemplating a conflict. That's why the U.S., the most powerful country in the world, and the United Nations, they must take steps. All I said was that why not send observers on along the line of control? Let the UN observers come and find out. India blames Pakistan. We are blaming India. Why not have observers there?
Mm-hmm. Trump, of course, also has a very close relationship now with Prime Minister Modi. Were you worried by Howdy Modi?
not by Howdy Modi. But this relationship is understandable because India is a huge market. And of course, every the country would like trading ties and benefits of this huge market. And that's fine. My only concern is not about the US-India relationship. My concern is that it's the direction India is going. And I'm worried about that. If you've read history and you read what happened in Nazi Germany, the sequence of events, it's striking resemblance. Nazi Germany between 1930 and 1934 went from a liberal democracy to a fascist totalitarian racial state. If you look at what is happening in India in these BJP 5 years, look where it's heading. And that's the danger bit. You know, and you're talking about a huge a country of 1.3 billion people and nuclear armed. So this is where the whole idea of United Nations was to prevent some sort of a conflict happening again. And this is a potential flashpoint, and that's why I think that President Trump and the UN should act.
So since we're at the World Economic Forum, let me ask a question about the economy. Pakistan's economy has crashed 13 times over the last 16 years and required an IMF bailout each time. Fitch, the credit rating agency, recently gave Pakistan a B rating, saying its economy is, quote, constrained by structural weaknesses reflected in weak development and social and governance indicators. The WEF's brand new social mobility index ranks Pakistan 79 below Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and India. Pakistan is among the lowest investment rates in the world and last year imported twice as much as it exported. You came into office promising a new Pakistan. What kind of reforms are you making to break this cycle and fix the economy? And why should investors have any more confidence this time than in the past?
You see, the Pakistan in the 60s was one of the fastest growing countries in Asia. Pakistan was industrializing faster than anyone else. It was a model which was copied by a lot of countries, and Pakistan was ahead of all the countries in the subcontinent. So my contention is that it's not lack of resources that make a country poor. My contention is that it is corruption why countries become poor. And why corruption? Because corruption does, number one, it destroys institutions. You can't make money if I'm the prime minister, if I have to make money. I cannot make money unless I destroy the state institutions, which would be a check on me. So all the justice system, the accountability bureau, the tax collection system has to be destroyed for me to make money. And that's what happens. I mean, if you look around in the developing world, look at some of the poor countries, they are resource rich, and yet there's massive poverty. So number one, it destroys state institutions, which is the biggest, taking out money is just one issue. But in the process, the destruction of the institutions is really what damages a country. And secondly, it is, because you have to take the money out of the country, because otherwise it will be spotted. So therefore, in taking the money out, it then starts, this money laundering starts putting pressure on the currency. And so when the currency devalues, it leads to inflation, more poverty, and then the money that should be spent on human development, invariably, I can tell you our experience, went into these mega projects for mega kickbacks. So the resources are distorted. So that's what happened to Pakistan.
What are you doing to change that?
So mid-80s onwards, that was a watershed. And that's when the two families took over and we sort of started going down.